trombones. Listen, Lord, a prayer. O Lord, come this morning, knee bowed and body bent before thy throne of grace. O Lord, this morning, bow our hearts beneath our knees and our knees in some lonesome valley. We come this morning like empty pitchers to a full fountain with no merits of our own. O Lord, open up a window of heaven and lean out far over the battlements of glory and listen this morning. Lord, have mercy on proud and dying sinners, sinners hanging over the mouth of hell who seem to love their distance well. Lord, ride by this morning. Mount your milk-white horse and ride this morning. And in your ride, ride by, oh hell. Ride by the dingy gates of hell and stop poor sinners in their headlong plunge. And now, O Lord, this man of God who breaks the bread of life this morning, shadow him in the hollow of thy hand and keep him out of the gunshot of the devil. Take him this morning. Wash him with hyssop inside and out. Hang him up and drain him dry of sin. Pin his ear to the wisdom post and make his words sledgehammers of truth, beating on the iron heart of sin. Lord, this morning, put his eye to the telescope of eternity and let him look upon the paper walls of time. Lord, turpentine his imagination. Put perpetual motion in his arms. Fill him full of the dynamite of thy power. Anoint him all over with the oil of thy salvation. And set his tongue on fire. And now, O Lord, when I've done drunk my last cup of sorrow, when I've been called everything but a child of God, when I've done traveled up the rough side of the mountain, oh, Mary's baby, when I start down the steep and slippery steps of death, when this old world begins to rock beneath my feet, lower me to my dusty grave in peace to wait for that great getting up morning. Amen.
Turn and face the cross. We give thanks to Shirley Clark, who found that poem to read by one of the Johnson brothers that you have in your bulletin. There's an insert about these two men who have gifted the church with their poetry and their ministry and their music. And the first song we're going to sing is a gift from both those brothers. In Black History Month, Erni, our organist, and Shirley this year helps us celebrate the African Americans in America here who have helped us in our faith. So that was a good start to that. I am glad you're worshiping here. We've got a baptism, so we got a whole bunch of visitors in the front up there. So make them feel welcome in the midst of worship as we celebrate God's love and joy that's come to us. Let us sing.
I
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Holy God, fed and nourished here by your word and prayers, may we be filled with joy and rain down that joy in your world. Amen. You may be seated. We are fortunate here again. We've got another baptism here at this 11 o'clock service. Come on, don't sit down. Courtney, Andrew, get on up here. We believe in the church that baptism is our entrance in to the body of Christ. It's where the Holy Spirit gets introduced to us the only way we know how. The Holy Spirit can do whatever the Holy Spirit wants to do. But if the church is part of it, this is how we know to be part of it. So we are welcoming today Chandler, Alexander, into the body of faith. You ready for this, huh? So I start with the parents, because Chandler doesn't know what's going on here. Who's being baptized today?
We present Chandler Alexander Swisher to be baptized today.
Called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have your child baptized into Christ?
We do.
All right. So when you bring a child forward, you're making the promises that he would make for himself. And those promises are to become part of the body of Christ, part of the church, to raise him in the church so that he knows who this Holy Spirit is that has become part of his life today. So that means doing things like putting scripture in his hands, teaching him the stories of faith. It means bringing him to worship so that he knows about giving joy to God in his worship. It means taking them to the ministries of children's ministries and confirmation ministries. Living a godly life so he knows what a godly life looks like. Bringing them to the table to eat when he's ready to do that so that he can take God in that special way too. Are these promises you're willing to make?
Mm-hmm.
All right. And sponsors, your promises are to check in and make sure these guys are keeping their promises, okay? Your promise is to encourage them as they raise Chandler in the faith so that he hears the Holy Spirit all of his life. Is that a promise you're willing to make? And congregation, our promise is to be church for them, to provide a place for them to raise their child in the faith, to share our resources, our abundance, so that there's plenty here for Chandler. Is that a promise that you're willing to make? If so, as one, let us say, we do. Amen. And in the midst of this, we check in on our faith, confessing the faith in who we are baptizing into. So I ask the parents, the sponsors, and all of you, do you reject sin and confess the faith of the church?
Amen.
Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? We renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw us away from God?
Renounce.
Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, by water you have saved your people. You formed this world from water. You saved the Israelites in the desert with water. You brought new life to a Samaritan woman with water. Save Chandler in these waters so that he will be reborn, your child, named, forever remembered by you in heaven. Amen. All right, you ready for this? Uh-huh. Okay, there we go. Oh, he's ready. Chandler Alexander Swisher, You are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's right. Well, Pastor Karl didn't waterboard you. That helped, huh? Okay, come here. Let's say a prayer. Bring him over here, Court. Oh, you got it? Holy God, in these waters you've given Chandler new birth. Now cleanse him from all sin and unrighteousness and raise him to eternal life. Sustain him forever with the gift of your Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. All right, let me take it. You were about ready to bite my fingers, huh? Chandler, they used to anoint kings of old with oil because they were part of royalty now. So you are now oiled, you are now anointed because you are part of God's royal family, now and forever. That's right. Wipe that right on my alb. That'll make our altar goat happy. And then we're going to light this candle, Chandler, okay? He's doing well, huh? There you go. He is a happy baby. Chandler, the Holy Spirit has become part of your life. It's a flame that lives within you now and forever. May you hold that flame, just not yet. And may it warm you. I'm going to give this to your mommy, okay? There we go. Congregation, please stand. I present to you our newest brother in Christ, Chandler Alexander Swisher. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please share God's love and God's peace with one another and with Chandler, our new brother. Amen. Yeah, yeah. He did good, huh? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Start getting wax on you. You did wonderful. Children can come or go. Children can go with Betsy, our children's minister. She's right at the back door. So if anyone, they take out children for about 20 minutes during the sermon and then bring them back if you want to send any of the children with her. Are you reading?
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children. Talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand, fix them as an emblem on your forehead, and write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. The word of the Lord. The reading for the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 8, 1 through 7. We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that has been granted to the churches of Macedonia. For during a severe ordeal of affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in wealth of generosity on their part. For as I can testify, they voluntarily give according to their means, and even beyond their means. Begging us earnestly for the privilege of sharing in this ministry to the saints, and this not merely as we expected. They gave themselves first to the Lord and by the will of God to us, so that we might urge Titus that as he had already made a beginning, so he should also complete this generous undertaking among you. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in love, our love for you, so we want you to excel into the generous undertaking. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Okay. Please stand as we welcome our gospel this morning. Gospel according to St. Matthew. So when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to speak and teaching them, saying this: Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets that had come before you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
you,
O Christ.
You may be seated. It's a lot of talking. There's something called the 2020 Challenge. I'm not sure whether you're aware of it or not. It's an idea that's kind of taken off on the internet that in 2020 we surprise one of our waiters or waitresses at a restaurant and leave 100% tip, just kind of out of the blue, just be a good generous gift that comes to them. And I wasn't aware of it either, but it became a thing over the holidays. There are a few celebrities did it, and it made news, and so that's how I learned of it. A celebrity named Donnie Wahlberg took part in the 2020 Challenge. Donnie Wahlberg, not only from New Kids on the Block, which I'm sure is how you all know him, he also is the older brother of the more famous Mark Wahlberg, and a television actor himself. And so he took his whole family and some friends, a large group of people, I read, to IHOP in New Jersey on January 2nd, right after the new year. And the bill came to $78 at this IHOP. And when he was writing out the check, he put a tip in for $2,020. Quite a bit more than 100%, you know, the 2020 challenge. And he wrote on there, 2020 challenge. And then the waitress, right, had a meltdown when she saw this gift that had come her way. And she was interviewed afterwards, and she shared just this abundant joy she had from this gift. She said it was the greatest thing that had ever happened to her. She said it was going to change her life, that she had just moved out of her home with her young son into an apartment, and they had absolutely no furniture, nothing. And this gift out of nowhere was going to allow her to buy beds and things like that that they needed. And I was watching that interview back when it happened and reflecting on it this week, and I thought to myself, you know what? It is pretty easy to be generous and fill people with joy. It really is. I don't know much about Donnie Wahlberg's financial situation. I'm guessing, though, that $2,000 gift doesn't mean he's going to have to eat dog food out of a can for the next few weeks, right? It's probably enough that he notices it, that he had to, like, check out his accounts before he did it that day to make sure it worked, but it was definitely enough for his waitress to notice it. You know, that gift that was nearly unnoticeable to him was very noticeable to her. And it filled her with joy. And here's the thing. It filled Donnie Wahlberg with joy, too. Right? I mean, you want to have some fun in your life? Be generous. Because it is joyful to be generous. There is no doubt about it. Donnie Wahlberg was filled with joy, I am sure, when he heard about this 2020 challenge and said, you know what, I'm going to do that. He was joy-filled when he checked out his bank accounts and kind of set it all up the day before. He was joy-filled when he wrote it down and he saw out of the corner of his eye this waitress that received it and had the meltdown. And he was joy-filled when the manager came to his table with the waitress standing behind him, probably praying, oh, please don't be a mistake. Please don't be a mistake. Sir, is this what you meant to do? Yes. That act that brought so much joy to that waitress brought so much joy to Donnie Wahlberg, too. Because that's what generosity does. It fills us with joy, it fills our neighbor with joy, and it fills the heavens with joy. Because God longs for us to be generous in our world. God longs for us to be generous with each other. This is God's plan, to make the kingdom of God known among us. I mean, the whole idea is that God, the Creator, made you, made me, made all this stuff, and still owns this stuff. We're just on loan with our bodies, ourselves, our things. And we're on loan in order to do good things with them. You heard in Deuteronomy that we are to love our neighbor, right? The way we show love, it is clear in the Old Testament and it is clear in the New Testament. The way we show love for God is by loving our neighbor, by serving them and providing for them. With the abundance we have, abundance of time, abundance of talents, abundance of wealth. Some of you have all three of that abundance. Others of you have one or two, but we all have some abundance that God longs for us to share and make known, right? I mean, today you could go to Best Buy and maybe some of you could buy that 85-inch TV that they got out now, right? And fill your wall with this TV. Or you could go to Best Buy and you could buy a 55-inch TV that's still pretty darn big. And then pick up a 40-inch on your way out and drop it off at your cousin who's just getting started. Or your nephew that needs something to boost, to give him hope. And think about the joy that small gift for you would be. God doesn't care what size TV you got or your cousin has, but he does care about us showing love for each other. And that joy builds on itself, and it multiplies in our world. And when we're generous, joy is known and the kingdom of God is seen. That's what Paul is saying in this Corinthians text. I don't know whether you caught it, because Paul's sometimes hard to understand. But what's going on here is Paul's writing to this church in Corinth, and he is saying, you know, this Macedonian church, they've been sending you some money. And they've been sending you some money, not because they are rich, because they aren't. They are under extreme poverty, he says. And we don't think they've been sending them money because they knew the Corinth church, because people didn't move around like that back then. They've been sending you money because they are full of joy, and they wanted to share it with their brothers and sisters so that Titus could do the good work in Corinth that God has called him to do. And Paul is telling them that in Corinth not to make them feel guilty that, oh my gosh, this church in Macedonia barely surviving themselves and sending us money. Paul wants them to know that so it fills them with joy, that abundant gift. And filled with joy, they will share that joy themselves. These ripples of joy. That's what happens, right? Macedonia gives a generous gift to the Corinth church, and the Corinth church becomes a legacy church that our faith is built upon. Donnie Wahlberg gives a generous gift to an unknown waitress in New Jersey, and she's able to allow her 5-year-old son to sleep on a bed rather than on a floor. You give a few extra dollars as a tip when you're sitting down there and take the 2020 challenge. And you're probably not changing anybody's life, but you're putting a smile on their face. And you're reminding them of the goodness of God's world. And ripples of love move out, and they transform our world. We spend all of our time wondering about evil and where it comes from and everything else. We should focus on the goodness of love and how that changes the world. Because when we're generous, our world is changed. We're changed when others are generous to us. So I was trying to think of an example of somebody being generous and bringing joy to someone else. And so I didn't have to Google long before I found an article from Reader's Digest, and didn't even know Reader's Digest was still a thing. I remembered reading it myself in the bathroom when I was a kid, but I didn't know that they still had them. And this man had written into this article, a man named Hasmik Madison. And Hasmik wrote that 30 years ago, when he was a young man, he got an illness that had to have an operation, and the operation had a long recovery time. And he was new at his job, I think he wrote, and in that long recovery time, the company decided they were no longer going to employ him any longer. So they fired him in his recovery. And then after they fired him, he got a note from the IRS saying that he was going to be audited because it appears that that company hadn't been withholding his taxes correctly all those years that he did work there, short amount as they were. And he said, so here I am, I'm not feeling well, I don't have a job, I got a note from the IRS that I owe thousands of dollars, and I feel miserable as a young man. So I decide to go to a Japanese American festival that night just to get out of the house. We have these kind of festivals in Columbus, a Greek American festival, Italian American festival, those sort of things. So he goes to this Japanese American festival in the California town he lives in, and he sits in the pavilion with an elderly Japanese man. And he chews this guy's ear off. He unloads everything that's going on in his life. All these disappointments and all these problems he's got. And he said the sweet man listened to it all and encouraged him. And he said it was just such a good gift to be able to share this with someone else who was intently listening. He didn't feel quite as alone. He thought that was gift enough. So he was really surprised 2 months later when he got a bouquet of flowers and with a check attached to it for $10,000 from this elderly Japanese man. And he said it was life-changing. That's what caught my eye when I was looking for a story, because that's the same thing that waitress said, right? And he said it was life-changing, not just because it got him over this financial patch. He probably could have figured out how to get over that at some point, I'm sure. It was life-changing because he felt like such a failure.
and he felt like nothing was ever going to go right. And this message of hope from a man I'm sure is not eating dog food in order to give it to him reminded him of an abundance out there and that he's part of something greater than himself. And he remained friends with that elderly man till he died about 10 years later, he said. And he said about 15 years ago, there were people in his neighborhood that he met, a family, and he was just getting to know them when they shared that they were going to be evicted from their house. And even though he didn't know them well, he knew what he had to do immediately. He went down the next day with them to the bank and paid $5,000 for their escrow to be gone. A good gift that filled that young family with joy. Close friends to this day of Hasmik in California. These ripples of joy that just create more joy, that change people, that transform us, that reveal the kingdom of God. You want to have fun in your life? Then be generous. Because generosity fills us with joy. If you brought commitment cards today, and if you've already put a number on there, I hope you put a number on there that fills you with joy. I hope you put a number on there that makes you smile. A number that reminds you of just how good God has been to you. Whatever number that is doesn't honestly matter. That's between you and God. Whatever number your neighbor puts, it's not a competition. They've got gifts and you've got gifts. Don't worry about that. Worry instead that you have released all this to God and you just want to find joy in being generous and joy in changing this community by the ministries we are doing. And joy in encouraging the brothers and sisters that are part of our education ministry, our music ministry, our property ministry, our outreach ministries, our welcome ministries. That your act of joy in this offering, in this promise for the new year, will be a ripple effect that'll make the kingdom of God known here in Reynoldsburg. Tyler. He's somewhere. There he goes. I just saw him. Tyler's going to sit down at that piano after he finishes his cigarette. And he's and he's going to lead us in the song that's on the center of your bulletin, not in your hymnal. And I want you to, he'll give you an instruction on that song. But if you haven't filled out your commitment card, I invite you to fill them out now as we start to sing this song. I'm going to have you stand in the midst of it. And when we stand in the midst of it, I would like for you to come forward and bring your cards and put them in this basket. If you're visiting today, do not bring forward a card. You're just simply our guests. And pray for us as we make promises for the year ahead. Tyler?
All right. Here we go. So, What you're going to do is anywhere you see the word refrain printed, that's going to be your part. So you don't have to worry about the verses or anything. But it is a relatively simple song to sing, so have fun with it. Enjoy it. Here we go.
God's works are so worthy of trust. God's mercy falls on the just and the right. Full of God's love is the earth. Rain down, your love on your people. Rain down, oh, rain down your love, God of life. We who revere and find hope in our God, live in the kindness and joy of God's wings. God will protect us from darkness and death. God will not leave us to starve. Rain down, oh, rain down. Rain down your love on your people. Rain down, oh, rain down. Rain down your love, God of life. God of creation, we long for your truth. You are the water of life that we thirst. Grant that your love and your peace touch our hearts. All of our hope lies in you.
That your love has rained down on us, that in 2019 allowed us to be a blessing for our community because of the abundance of time, talent, and wealth that our brothers and sisters shared. We pray that the promises made today will be another good, heavy rain in our community, a rain of love serving our neighbor as a sign of our love for you. Lord, rain down your love on Reynoldsburg, so that the kingdom of God is made known by the work of your people, called into a life of Christ with Chandler and others. We pray this morning for those who financially are strapped and worried, like Hasmeek in our story. May they receive an abundant gift to remind them of your love. Pray for those whose relationships aren't working out as they should, who are estranged from family or friends, that your love might rain down on them and remind them of your goodness. And we pray for all those who need healing among us, physical healing, Kimberly Beery, Meg Reidler, Susan Franklin, Lauren Blake, Holly Hessler, Julie Searles, Jennifer Solt, Susie Klee, Jack Dickey, Egon Carsonson, Mary Thompson, Sharon Will, Helen Schoenhart, Jim McNamara, Mary Lou Conkle, Julie Meter, Deb Drum, and others named aloud now. Lord, at the end of this prayer, let us sing this refrain one more time as our prayer this morning. God said, amen. All right, you may be seated. We're going to receive one of those good gifts from our chancel choir, who's going to come forward as you share whatever wealth you brought for God's kingdom today. and give thanks with the song in your bulletin. Let us pray. Holy God, out of the abundance you have given us, we have shared to make abundance in your world. Bless all these gifts of wine, bread, and wealth so that your kingdom might find joy and be made known in the giving of it. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, we celebrate the love that we have found in the waters of baptism with Chandler and the words from Scripture and prayers and sermons and in the melody of song. And we celebrate the love that we will find now in this bread and wine, this meal of promise that Jesus has given us to share among ourselves. And have your spirit show up when we do. For in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. And he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me. And again after supper, he took the cup and he blessed and he gave for all to drink. Saying, this cup is a sign of the new covenant shed in my blood. For you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this wine, we proclaim the very mystery of faith, that Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Transform us with your love. Rain down your spirit upon us so that we might transform our world by that same love. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A good meal down for all of you to share. You may sit while you wait for an usher to lead you forward. We have a lot of visitors here today. May they all know that they are welcome at this meal. It's not a Lutheran meal. It's God's meal, and you're a child of God. So come forward, take an empty cup, receive the bread, and have the wine poured into that cup for you. Here, Keegan. Thank you. God's waiting for you.
The body of Christ is given for you.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bless you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Holy God, fed and nourished by your very presence, may we go and share that abundance with our world. Amen. We give thanks for you in worship today. Check out that blue bulletin board for ways you can be in ministry in the weeks ahead, where we're serving and when we're gathering again on Wednesday night for a meal. We got Pastor Tim Kinsley, who's going to be teaching on prayer here on Wednesdays in February at 6:30, so come back for that. Beyond the good meal at 5:30. We also have... there's one more thing. Oh, the reading buddies are starting again. If you did that last year, we gather with our kindergartners here at our school, here at Messiah Christian School. We have to wait till they learn how to read before we can read with them, and so they're at that level now, I guess. So they're ready for us. If you can come during the day and read with them, respond to that blurb that's in the blue bulletin board to Betsy, and she'll get you on the schedule and tell you what it's all about and how to do it. So that's a good thing. February newsletter's out. If you didn't get in on the email, or go to our website to get it, there are some hard copies as you're leaving. And finally, when you leave, you saw as you came in two big pots. It's Super Bowl Sunday. We join with Christian churches across the nation to raise money for local food pantries. So our money, I think it says LSS and Heart Food Pantry, but I think all of it's going to go to Heart Food Pantry. And so put your wealth in the midst of that and vote for whatever team you think is going to win. We actually call that in, and our predictions go with the predictions all across the country, and we'll see whether we beat the Vegas odds or not. So I think they're pretty close right now, just like the odds are in Vegas. So we're there. So pick your team and go. Let's stand. And a blessing as we leave. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you all with favor and grant you God's peace. Amen. Please sing this beautiful song as we leave this morning.
Hymn 720 in your red hymnal.
Thank you.
in that peace and serve the Lord.